2 hours ago, you said 100 million then. Now you say 60 million.
I say 60 million is perhaps the highest price we should be prepared to pay in a war.
What's the difference between 60 million dead and 100 million?
40 million.
Some difference.
Are you prepared to say the saving of 40 million lives is of no importance?
You miss the point, Professor. The saving of those 60 million lives is what's important.
Face facts, Mr. Foster. We're talking about war. I say every war, including thermonuclear war, must have a winner and a loser. Which would you rather be?
In a nuclear war, everyone loses. War isn't what it used to be.
It's still the resolution of economic and political conflict.
Oh, what kind of resolution with 100 million dead?
It doesn't have to be 100 million.
Even 60!
The same as 1,000 years ago, sir. When you also had wars, it wiped out whole peoples. The point is still who wins and who loses, the survival of a culture.
A culture with most of its people dead, the rest dying, the food poisoned, the air unfit to breathe? You call that a culture?
Yes, I do, Mr. Foster. I am not a poet. I am a political scientist who would rather have an American culture survive than a Russian one.
But what would it be like? I mean, really like, who would survive?
Who would survive? Interesting question. I would predict convicts and file clerks. And the worst convicts, those deep down in solitary confinement, and the most ordinary file clerks, probably for large insurance companies, because they would be in fireproof rooms, protected by tons of the best insulator in the world, paper. Then imagine what will happen. The small group of vicious criminals will fight the army of file clerks for the remaining means of life. The convicts will know violence, but the file clerks will know organization. Who do you think will win? It's all hypothesis, of course, but fun to play around with. And time to go home. I didn't mean to hold forth so long. I don't usually come to a supper party and talk right through the breakfast.
Oh, nonsense, Professor. We were fascinated. Let's hope we didn't keep you from the work.
Not at all. I've got a 10 o'clock meeting at the Pentagon. Plenty of time to get home and change.
You must come again, Professor Grunerstetter, with your wife this time.
I'd be delighted.
Mr. Secretary.
Yes, General Parker?
Mr. Knapp here knows as much about electronic gear as anyone. He'd like to say something.
The more complex an electronic system gets, the more accident-prone it is. Sooner or later, it breaks down.
What breaks down?
A transistor blows, a condenser burns out. Sometimes they just get tired, like people.
Mr. Knapp overlooks one factor. The machines are supervised by humans. Even if the machine fails, the human being can always correct the mistake.
I wish you were right. The fact is, the machines work so fast. They are so intricate. The mistakes they make are so subtle that very often a human being just can't know whether a machine is lying or telling the truth.
Well, maybe this time there wasn't any failure. Maybe the Russians have come up with a way to mask the real position of Group 6. Maybe Group 6 is flying back to the States right this minute.
And what's on the board? Northern Lights?
Maybe a group of Soviet planes up there for just that reason, to convince us that we've accidentally launched a bomber group against them.
For what purpose?
As an excuse to retaliate.
If they wanted to do that, they wouldn't need an excuse. They'd simply attack.
This way, they've made us commit a group of our fighter planes, our first line of defense. Made us kill our own men.
I disagree with Colonel Cassio's analysis. I think we have to assume that it is our accident and not their plan.
I go along
with you, General.
In my opinion, they will take no action at all.
They're not going to just sit there, Professor.
I think if our bombers get through, the Russians will surrender.
Who's this professor, Mr. Secretary? What's he doing there?
Professor Grunerstetter is a civilian advisor to the Pentagon, General. Will you explain your statement, Professor?
The Russian aim is to dominate the world. They think that communism must succeed eventually if the Soviet Union is left reasonably intact. They know that a war would leave the Soviet Union utterly destroyed. Therefore, they would surrender.
But suppose they feel they can knock us off first?
They know we might have a doomsday system. Missiles that will go into action days, even weeks after a war is over, and destroy an enemy even after that enemy has already destroyed us.
Maybe they think that even capitalists aren't that insane to want to kill after they themselves have been killed.
These are Marxist fanatics, not normal people. They do not reason the way you reason, General Black. They are not motivated by human emotions such as rage and pity. They are calculating machines. They will look at the balance sheet and they will see they cannot win.
Then you suggest doing what?
Nothing.
Nothing?
The Russians will surrender and the threat of communism will be over forever.
That's a lot of hogwash. Don't kid yourself. There'll be Russian generals who will react just as I would. The best defense is a good offense. They see trouble coming up, take my word for it, they'll attack, and they won't give a damn what Marx said.
Mr. Secretary, I am convinced that the moment the Russians know bombs will fall on Moscow, they will surrender. They know that whatever they do then, they cannot escape destruction. Don't you see, sir, this is our chance. We never would have made the first move deliberately, but Group 6 has made it for us by accident, and we must take advantage of it. History demands it. We must advise the president not to recall those planes.
General, is this section any more important than this section?
Not anymore, no.
Is that plane continued on the course? It should be a certain
message within
the last half hour or so.
Excuse me,
sir. I would think so, yes.
Every minute we wait works against us. Now, Mr. Secretary, now is when we must send in a first strike.
We don't go in for sneak attacks. We had that done to us at Pearl Harbor.
And the Japanese were right to do it. From that point of view, we were their mortal enemy. As long as we existed, we were a deadly threat to them. Their only mistake was that they failed to finish us at the start. And they paid for that mistake at Hiroshima.
You're talking about a different kind of war.
Exactly. This time, we can finish what we start. And if we act now, right now, our casualties will be minimal.
You know what you're saying.
Do you believe that communism is not our mortal enemy?
You're justifying murder.
Yes. To keep from being murdered.
In the name of what? To preserve what? Even if we do survive, what are we? Better than what we say they are? What gives us the right to live then? What makes us worth surviving, Grotescheller, that we are ruthless enough to strike first?
Yes! Those who can survive are the only ones worth surviving.
Fighting for your life isn't the same as murder.
Where do you draw the line once you know what the enemy is? How long would the Nazis have kept it up, General, if every Jew they came after had met them with a gun in his hand? But I learned from them, General Black. Oh, I learned.
You learned too well, Professor. You learned so well that now there's no difference between you and what you want to kill.